Penguin Random House Audio presents Quiet Until the Thaw by Alexandra Fuller. Read for you by Alma Cuervo. TDF, 1940 to 2015. Nunc dimittis servum tuum, Domine. Secundum verbum tuum in pace. Life is a circle, and we as common people are created to stand within it and not on it. I am not just of the past, but I am the past. I am here. I am now, and I will be for tomorrow. Oglala, Lakota Maxim. There are only two or three human stories, and they go on repeating themselves as fiercely as if they had never happened before. Willa Cather, O Pioneers. Quiet Until the Thaw. Her name tells of how it was with her. The truth is, she did not speak in winter. Everybody learned not to ask her questions in winter, once this was known about her. The first winter this happened, we looked in her mouth to see if something was frozen, her tongue maybe, or something else in there. But after the thaw, she spoke again, and told us it was fine for her that way. So each spring, we looked forward to that. Swampy Cree Narrative Naming Poem. Translation from The Wishing Bone Cycle by Howard A. Norman. All persons, living and dead, are purely coincidental. Kurt Vonnegut, Timequake. Part 1. Quiet Until the Thaw. They say Rick Overlooking Horse didn't talk much. Actually, it was a little more than that. From the start, even for an Indian, his silence was bordering on worrying. For example, in his fourth spring, when you choose Watson shot him in the leg with an arrow, he didn't go wailing to his grandmother like any normal kid. He turned his back on his res cousin's mocking laughter and limped away with the arrow still in his leg, down the hill toward the third in a row of tar paper lean-tos on what is now 2nd Street in Manderson Village. Then he stood in the kitchen, silent as ever, staring at his closest immediate relation. Mina Overlooking Horse, accustomed to her grandson's silence, took a long time to look up from the back seat of the 1935 Ford coupe that had served as her sofa since it had been torn from its crumpled mother chassis in a ditch outside Shadron, Nebraska. Then she noticed the dark, viscous pool spreading on the earth floor beneath Rick Overlooking Horse's feet and the arrow juddering from his leg. "Eh? You're making a mess of everything," she said. But Rick Overlooking Horse just blinked and stared at the dirt on which he was standing. Maybe he was wondering why you choose had just shot him in the leg with an arrow. Or maybe he was wondering how he could mess everything up any worse than it already was. But no one would ever know what he was thinking about this or much of anything else because the child wouldn't talk. It was like that Swampy Cree Indian poem, Quiet Until the Thaw, as if his tongue must be frozen. Eventually, his grandmother and some of his more concerned immediate relations thought to look in his mouth to make sure. But nope. Everything was all defrosted and accounted for. Rick Overlooking Horse was simply a child and then a man of shockingly few words. The eternal nature of everything, as described by Mina Overlooking Horse. By the time Rick Overlooking Horse was fixing to enter his second decade, he had uttered, all told, about enough words to fill a pamphlet from the Resurrection Ministry outfit based out of Dallas, Texas. And those pamphlets were exceedingly short, designed as they were by little ladies with big hair, for heathen Indians who had been out in the sun too long, so to speak. Although, to be fair, the little ladies were just doing their Christian bit. And to be accurate, some of them were very far from what you might describe as little. Plus, this was back in the early 1950s, which was a confusing time for a lot of people, particularly for people who counted on time being linear, one thing following another, one foot in front of the other, one breath after the other, from cradle to grave, accounting for all the time between birth and death, but accounting for none of the time between death and birth. Mina made an attempt to get that confusion squared away, early and often. They say you've been here from the very start, and you'll be here to the very end, she told Rick Overlooking Horse when he was just 9 years old. Every last drop of you and everything around you, nothing has ever been taken away. Nothing will ever be added. Then she sighed, as if the very idea exhausted and perhaps saddened her. Eh? They say that's true for you. It's true for you, choose, and it's true for me. Yep, it's true for the whole steaming rotten lot of us. Mina let this sink in for a moment. Like that breath you just took? In the beginning, a dinosaur breathed that breath, then a tree, then an ant, then you, now me. And maybe it'll be you choose next. Or maybe that breath will sink to the bottom of the ocean for one of those blind, ugly fish. Or maybe it will be someone's dying breath. You see? They say you just borrowed that breath. It wasn't yours to begin with, and it won't be yours to end with. Rick Overlooking Horse's tiny, blown mind. 9-year-old Rick Overlooking Horse gave this a lot of thought, and his mind did what all minds have done since time immemorial while dealing with such a boundless, mysterious, obdurate idea. It blew up. Quite literally, it stopped working the way most people's minds work, and it started off on its own kick. And that made Rick Overlooking Horse sleepless and also exalted. It was like angels should have been hovering in the clouds above his head, singing a chorus of sweet surrender. It was like his mind should have been able to trip heavenward on shafts of sunlight. It was like that. Rick Overlooking Horse tried to come to some resolution about why he had chosen to be born now, at this time. He felt he needed some certainty. Something that would make him feel less vulnerable, less miraculous, less unlikely. But in the end, he could not comprehensively solve a single thing about the reasons for his existence. All his answers opened trapdoors to further questions, and those in turn revealed yet more trapdoors that slapped open to yet more unanswered questions. Rick Overlooking Horse concluded that even half believing that you might be part of an incomprehensible, infinite, celestial phenomenon does not necessarily help a person figure out what to do with the bit of more or less graspable earthly life he or she has been given. For a start, he reasoned, a lot of what you do with your life depends on the body you find yourself in. To be born at this time, in this place, a more or less whole and healthy human being, for example, surely brings with it different complications and obligations than being born a more or less whole and healthy nematode, more or less any time or place, let's just say. So here I am, Rick Overlooking Horse thought, and here it is, my life as a human being. What are my choices? Well, Mina would argue that just for starters, being born into this world in this time was one choice. You could have chosen not to be born now. She says this to Yuchus whenever he winds himself up to whining pitch, which is often. You could have been born when you had a chance to hunt buffalo and live the way of all our ancestors. Yeah, and don't look at me like that, little tapeworm. You ain't my doing, you're your doing. Although, to be fair to the choosers, Rick Overlooking Horse figured perhaps almost all choices are mostly illusion, given that almost all people seem to be in a prison of their own making. Mina Overlooking Horse in a prison of resentment. You choose Watson in a prison of need. Some of the more concerned immediate relations in a prison of fear, despair, and/or anger. And for certain, almost all people are in a prison of someone else's making. The way Rick Overlooking Horse saw it, one go-around, for example, a person might be a Oglala Lakota Oyate with the whole high plains of buffalo to hunt. Next go-round, he's a red nigger orphan stuck with cornmeal, commodity cheese, and beans, and Mina Overlooking Horse for a caretaker. Was that your choice, really? Mina Overlooking Horse's Winter Count. Waniyetu, meaning from first snowfall to first snowfall. Wowapi, meaning flat surface. Waniyetu Wowapi, meaning winter count. The year she got the boys, Mina Overlooking Horse drew two round bundles with wide open mouths that represented the boys, and a bigger stick figure with a straight across mouth that represented her. She wrote the number 216, and underneath it, the number 12. Then she drew a line under that and wrote 204. Every winter count.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.